Go.
Hi, my name is Ryan, and this summer I was working in Dr. Bean's labs with a group mostly concerned with the CMS detector, which is part of the LHC in CERN. So, brief overview, we're looking at, I'm going to give some background on kind of the pixel detectors at the CMS, which is part of, it's a larger part of the thing that I was working on this summer. Then, most of what I was concerned with was developing a BERT. I'm going to talk about what that is, the smaller part inside of that, current problems, and so background on the CMS detector, it stands for Compact Muon Solenoid. It is inside of here, this is the whole CMS, and it has, I think, 5 layers in it. I was mostly concerned with the most interior layer, which is circled in there. Those are all silicon pixel detectors, and that's going to take the brunt of the interactions from all these particles, because they're colliding, they're getting a bunch of debris from that, and almost all that's going to be passing through there in some capacity. That's a lot of information, so we need to find some way to filter that out. Mostly with triggers. So the data flow there is it goes from the pixels, that's all digital, into a central trip, which will filter out what's useful data and what's just not useful. And then we're going to send that through cables to an adapter. So the issue with the cables is that because we're working with subatomic particles, we can't have anything too big in volume or size on there because that's going to get in the way of all of those interactions that you're doing. So we have to use cables with less size, which also means less shielding. To find ways to work around that, eventually the design solution was the flex cables that you see in the top right corner. They have a bit of shielding from just using twisted pairs, but they're also potentially less reliable, and that was our job, was to find out how reliable they are. So if it passes through those cables, it'll take it to an adapter, which converts it into fiber optics, but from there, it's easy enough to send that information where it needs to go. So all this data is serially transmitted, which basically means it's just binary, it's just zeros and ones, one after another. So instead of sending like 5 at a time or something that makes it parallel, it's just a stream of binary. Because there's so much happening in there, we need to start moving out data at really high speeds. Eventually, we wanted to test this up at 1 gigahertz, which is, I believe, a billion bits per second, which means these cables have to be really high quality and be able to sustain good reliability at such high speeds. So, the way that we're going to test this is with a board called the Vertex 707. So we essentially create an environment that simulates data you might see inside of the CMS detector at CERN by programming an FPGA, which is just a firmware device inside the Vertex 707, to simulate all of that data coming through these cables. So you see here, we have, this is the full Vertex 707. That's the cable that we were looking at earlier. So there's going to be two sets of, well, it's the same set of data. Sent out in 2 different directions. One's going to be contained within the void, so we have a control. We know this is what it's supposed to look like. Then we're going to send it through that cable and see what we actually get back, whether or not it's the same thing. So one of the limitations of this board is that it uses Legato, which is a programming environment, and it's compatible with that, which is all fine. It's not compatible with Cortis. The reason that's an issue is because we had a working Cortis BERT, which is the testing program that we were just looking at, already functioning. But we can't use it on this, because it uses Legato, so that was our main issue. So most of what we did was having to switch that over. So the BERT stands for a bit error rate test. It's kind of what I talked about earlier, where we're going to send 2 streams of data through and then compare them at the end. The target that we're trying to get to is one error in 10 to the 15th bits, which is the maximum amount of information. If we can achieve that, that's incredibly reliable. That's basically what we need. Before I got here, Billy Lucas, who recently just left, was working with this, and her results actually showed that we had no errors found. She was working with a BERT that actually was in Legato, so it was compatible with this piece of all before we got here. But she wasn't finding any errors, which could be a good thing, because the cable's really good, but it also could be that there's something wrong with the BERT. Now, Legato, we wanted to just open it up and look and see, like, okay, what's happening with all the data? They didn't want that, because of copyright issues and legal things that I didn't pay attention to. So instead, we had to develop our own through Cortis in Legato. So this is the schematic that Mario developed, who's one of the other people working in our lab, with Rob Young, who's the electrical engineer, that just kind of made it pretty easy. The whole process starts with this ROM right here, which is where the bitstream that we talked about earlier is stored. That's going to send it through this full path here, where it's going to be encoded in a few different ways that I'll talk about later. It's going to be passed through something called the CDR, which is the clock data recovery, which is important because it's giving a problem right now. So get more of that later. It's going to send it through this whole thing. Down here, it's going to check to see, are these two different data streams the same thing? Are they different? If so, how different are they? And then it's going to give all that information again and give us an error phrase. So the encoding that I was talking about is 4-bit, 5-bit encoding and NRZR. So what it is since we're sending this data through two different paths, one's all the way through a cable, that's going out, compared to just being inside the board, that's way longer, which means it's going to take more time to send it through that distance. So we have to have some method of making sure that those two bit streams are aligned, so we can actually compare them. And that's what the CDR is, the clock data recovery. The clock data recovery just looks at it, but because it's only zeros and ones, it's hard for it to tell where exactly in the bit stream it is. If you have a set of like four zeros like you have right here, it doesn't know which zero you're at. Because the second, third one, fourth one, it can't really tell very well. So what we do to fix that is something called NRZI inverted. NRZI not return zero inverted, which basically just makes sure that doesn't happen. It just makes sure that there aren't too many zeros or ones in a row, so the CDR doesn't get confused. And we also wanted to put that in 5-bit. So initially all of the data that we had to send through was in hexadecimal, which is a stream of 5 characters, 0 through 9, and then A through F, which on this chart correspond to different sets of bits, either 4 or 5 bits. The 4 bit is not NRZI, so CDR wouldn't like that, but we wanted to put it into 5 bit, which in addition to being NRZI included, also is more data. And the more data we can send through, the more results we get, which means we have more information. So one of the things that I was working on before was pre-encoding all of that information into the 5-bit NRZI with Python, and then just putting that into a ROM, which we just finished up with, and now it's done. So current problems like I talked about, the clock data recovery, and so I don't have any pictures of this, so forgive me for that, because this just happened like 10 minutes before I walked out of the room. But so I'm going to try to go on. Apologies in advance. But basically, so we're sending through we're sending through our clocks, which should roughly look like we have a 1, a 0, 1, 0, and then 2 1s, which is high, and then 2 0s, like this. And we're sending that pattern through over and over and over again to make sure that we can line them up through the CDR intersection, doing what it's supposed to do. Now, the problem that we were running into before I left is that it wasn't doing that. It was giving us just like crazy that goes right here, and then it would go crazy for a little bit, and we had to line it up through our signal ports, which were getting all messed up. So I don't have too much information on that right now because we just found it, but that's the issue that we're working on right now, is getting those aligned. And then once we're done with that, we just have to finish developing all the other parts of the bird, which will be mostly just the error checking and then porting it out to an actual computer, so it can be implemented, which is good. And then once we have that full functioning bird, eventually, this could be probably future, we're not sure, we can run tests on the cables, which is the whole goal of bird, right? To see if they're effective. And those cables are right now planned for a upgrade to the CMS detector that's supposed to go in 2023. If it goes as planned, but that's 6 years from now, so yeah. So that's what we're
working on. So Ryan, I guess I don't have a good feel for do you want a fault rate of 1 out of 10 to 15?
Yes.
You're running What language are you writing anyway?
So this is in VHDL.
In VHDL.
Yeah.